Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the May meeting of the Alternative Technology Association. It's great to see such a fine turnout tonight, and thanks especially to people who have driven down from the Flinders Ranges, especially for this meeting. If this is your first ATA meeting and you're not aware of what the organisation is about, we take an interest in renewable energy, energy efficiency, water management, waste management, all that sort of stuff. And we produce two magazines. One is Renew, which is fairly technical about the theory behind a lot of this stuff, and the Sanctuary, which is case studies of inspiring designs of energy efficient houses. They're available in all good news agents and in some of the dodgier ones as well. Okay, tonight our presenter is Finn Peacock. Finn founded Solar Quotes in 2009 with the intention of helping people to find the best value and best quality PV system, and he subsequently added storage to his belt, and that's mainly what he'll be talking about tonight. So please welcome Finn.
Can everyone hear me now? Is that better? Cool. So yes, my name's Finn. I run a website called Solar Quotes. We help people get quotes for solar and batteries now from multiple solar installers and avoid the shonks, because there's a lot of shonks in the solar industry, unfortunately. A lot less than they used to be, but they're still around. So we started in, well, I started in January 2009. I started in Brighton Public Library because the Wi-Fi was free, with $500, put up a few pages about solar. Previous to that, I'd worked at CSIRO in their solar division. And to cut a long story short, the site's grown. Over 1 in 40 homes in Australia is now used it to get quotes for solar. So that's pretty good, and we're one of the most popular solar websites in Australia. And that's all run out of Adelaide. I've got a team of six that work for me, well, a team of five that work for me, so there's six all together, and we're all distributed across Australia, and there's one guy in Portugal, actually. So, and we all work from home. So it's quite a 21st century business, if you like. We all collaborate over the internet, work from home, and get, well, literally millions of hits a month. So obviously in the last, well, since Elon, I blame Elon Musk, since Elon Musk came out in May last year, which obviously there's been a lot of interest in batteries to store your solar energy, and we've seen a lot of that interest, and especially since kind of March this year, the power wall was finally released into Australia. People have, you know, been coming to the site, getting quotes for solar, getting quotes for batteries, getting quotes for battery upgrades, and just really hungry for information on batteries. So that's what I'm going to talk about today, and I'm going to give my personal view on batteries, which a lot of people may disagree with, and also the best advice I can give if you want to buy batteries in 2016. And if you've got any questions, feel free to interrupt me. I actually prefer it that way, but I'm happy to answer anything, any questions at the end too. How do I go next? Yeah, cool. So I'm going to start at the absolute beginning, so excuse me if I'm teaching you the subject. I'll start with the five main battery types. Obviously, first there's lead acid. That's the old, you know, the old faithful, if you've got an off-grid system. Anyone in the room got off-grid? Have you got lead acid? You just got it 2 days ago. Wow. Cool. You don't know what kind of batteries. You don't know what kind of batteries they are. Okay. Lead acid. Do you know how many kilowatt hours? Okay. Yeah, right. And how's that? Sorry? Yeah. Yeah, got you. So, yeah, lead acid are great. They work really well. They're cheap. They're a known quantity. They're very reliable if they're treated well. They're recyclable. I think they're pretty much 100% recycled, which is from the environmental point of view, which is obviously important. It's definitely important to me. They're good. They're good. The problem with them is, if they get too hot, they degrade very, very quickly. They're just a dumb battery, if you like. And what I mean there is that all the smarts to protect the battery are in the battery controller or the battery inverter. So they're actually very, very easy to kill. If you overcharge them, over-discharge them, don't charge them enough, discharge them too far, you can kill them in a matter of months. So in the good old days when most batteries were sold to off-grid people, the off-grid installers really know their stuff. They very well qualified, they knew how to treat the batteries. The owners of off-grid systems generally are very well educated about how to treat the batteries. So they lasted a long time and they're very good, they're very reliable, and they're still the cheapest battery out there in terms of kilowatt hours of storage. So if you've got an off-grid system and you're reliant on your power supply to have if the batteries fail, your power supply goes down, you've got no grid backup. Lead acid are great. They're the ones I'd recommend. There's an improvement on the lead acid battery that was actually developed at CSIRO when I was working there in 2006. So that's 10 years ago they invented this. And that's the Ultra battery. So, I mean, the guy that invented it would probably not approve of me saying this, but it's basically a lead acid battery with a super capacitor bolted on to the terminal. It's a lot more fancy than that, but that's the high level concept. So the beauty of that is you get all the benefits of lead acid, but you don't get lots of the disadvantages. So I think it's three times longer life. They're much harder to kill because they've got a lot of smarts built into the battery now. So if you tell it to over discharge, it just won't do it, stuff like that. And they can do a much faster charge and discharge. The main disadvantage of these batteries is, in my opinion, they're vaporware. I've been asking the company for years when they're going to be available. They were at a show last year. Well, there's boxes of them at a show last year, but I've never seen one in the field. And we regularly ring up the company to ask when their battery's coming out, how much it's going to cost, what the specs are, and they can't tell us. So if it ever comes out, it will be great. But it's been 10 years, it's still not out. So we'll see what happens. Then you've got the famous one, the lithium ion. This is the one that Elon Musk made very popular. And as you can see from that slide, I've just put six there, but there's probably 25 on the market around the world for home storage. Benefits of lithium ion, low maintenance. You don't really have to worry about them. And that's because they all generally have fancy BMS systems. Some of them have fancy cooling systems. They generally look after themselves. They've got a high cycle life between 3,000 cycles and the best one I think is 15,000 cycles, which is amazing. Very high depth of discharge. The good ones will go up to 95% depth of discharge, which means you can discharge within 95% without killing it. That compares to kind of 40% for a good lead acid. That's pretty good. High energy density, so they're fairly small, fairly compact, which is handy if you're sticking them in your garage. The biggest problem with them is they explode, and they do explode. I believe two exploded in Sydney last week, two lithium ion batteries. The good ones don't explode very often, but they still explode occasionally. And the cheap ones, well, they're going to explode a lot more often. So you can imagine the problem we had with cheap solar panels. We've still got this problem with cheap solar panels catching fire, failing, cheap DC isolators catching fire and failing. The problem's going to be amplified with lithium ion batteries. There's going to be a lot of cheap lithium ion batteries coming in from China, and a lot of good ones coming in from China, but the cheap ones are, I think we're going to see a lot more explosions because they get thermal runaway. And if you haven't really thought through the battery management system, the cooling system, it doesn't take much money to explode. So, it depends on the technology. So the Tesla is actively cooled, but there's ones in there like the silver one in the corner, the first one, that's not tactically cooled. You don't depends on the technology. Some of them need to be active. But there is thermal runaway. The LG one, which is the big silver box at the beginning, that's in pouches. So I've been told that you can fire bullets into the thing, it doesn't explode. I don't know if that was a salesman's exaggeration. Some are safer than others. But they are starting to burst into flames around Australia. So, yeah. Sorry, DOD is depth of discharge. So that's how much you can discharge the battery. So if you've got a 10 kilowatt hour battery and it's got a 20% depth of discharge, you can only actually use 2 kilowatt hours of storage. So be very careful when you're... I'll go through some examples, but be very careful when you're looking at batteries. You've got the headline rate, the nominal storage, if you like. So for the Tesla, when that originally came out, that was, and I'll go through this example in detail, they claimed that was a 7 kilowatt hour battery. When it went on the market, they dropped that to 6.4 kilowatt hours. If you look at the specs, you're actually only warranted to get 5.44 kilowatt hours out of it for the first 2 years, and then it drops quite substantially. So always look at the depth of discharge. Some batteries will let you go over the depth of discharge, but they just won't last very long. No one knows how to recycle them. No one in the world knows how to recycle a lithium-ion battery. There's lots of ideas out there, including freezing them in liquid nitrogen and then smashing them into bits and grinding them up. But as far as I'm aware, there's no lithium-ion recycling solution in the world today. Lots of people working on it, so it's taking a bit of a... I'm sure they'll get there. But the reality of it is, as far as I'm aware, there's no one that can recycle a lithium-ion battery yet, including Tesla. I'm happy to be proven wrong on that, but I can't find one. Hi. What happens to them? Well, I don't know. Very few of them have come to the end of their life. They're just starting to replace the batteries in the first Tesla cars. It's a really good question. It's a really good question. I don't know what they're doing with the batteries. They do. I don't know. It's a good question. I'm happy to be wrong on the recycling, but I've got research out and I can't find it. I don't know. Is it? I thought it was lead acid. Is it lithium ion? Okay. I don't know what they're doing with those. Yeah. I don't know what they're doing with those. It'd be interesting. What's that? Okay. Yeah, right. You know what they're doing with the old battery? Nissan have just announced they're bringing out a home storage product which is using old car batteries, because obviously it's less of an issue if the capacity's dropped 50% in a stationary battery than a moving battery. So, I don't know, maybe they're all in a warehouse somewhere, but Nissan's putting them in that box. A really, really exciting battery that's recently developed and has an Adelaide connection is the Red Flow. Apparently it's not technically a flow battery, but it's kind of variation on a flow battery. It's a zinc bromide battery. Our local boy Simon Hackett is the chairman of the company, and he's getting really involved in developing the software to make this thing workable in people's homes. So this is completely changing how you think about batteries. So this is actually an electromechanical system. It's not a chemical system like almost every other battery. The big tank there you can see is full of an electrolyte called it's a zinc bromide is the electrolyte. So what happens is, if you want to charge that battery, you pump, there's two pumps in there. To charge the battery, you pump the electrolyte over some flat anodes, and it coats those anodes in zinc. And when you want to discharge the battery, you switch the other pump on and pump it the other way, and it decoats, strips the zinc off the electrode. So it's storing the energy chemically, but in a mechanical fashion, if you know what I mean. So it's quite a complicated electromechanical machine. It's got two pumps, it's got pump controllers, it's got two tanks. It pumps the bromide, zinc bromide, from one tank to the other. So it's a really interesting engineering solution because you've got to optimize an electromechanical solution. So I'm actually a mechatronic engineer, so I get quite excited about systems like that. And they've refined that to a very high degree. So the beauty of this thing is it's rated at 10 kilowatt hours of storage, and it has got 100% depth of discharge. And until the day it fails, which they warrant it for 10 years, they're fairly confident it will last a lot longer than that, but they can't actually say that in the market because of the Australian consumer law, which is implied warranty. You've got to be very careful with batteries, that you don't imply the warranty is longer than it is, or the ACCC will make you honour that implied warranty. So if I'm a battery salesman and I say to you, this battery's got a 10-year warranty, but it'll last 20 years probably, you can prove I've said that 15 years down the line when that battery fails, you can hold me to that implied warranty. So bear that in mind when you're buying batteries, and bear that in mind if you're selling batteries as well. It's that wide, that high. Yeah. 10 kilowatt hours. Yeah, and 10 years later, when it's still working, it'll still be 10 kilowatt hours. It does not degrade at all. Yeah. You can also go into a hibernation state, which is they put the fluids in certain places and they do something to the electrodes, and it will not be, you can store it for an infinite, they literally use the word, an infinite amount of time, and it won't degrade. So compare that to a lead acid battery or lithium ion battery, which will degrade over time if you leave it. You can put it into this hibernation mode, you can go away on holiday for 10 years, you can come back and it will have just as much capacity as when you left it, because it's electromechanical, not chemical. Yeah, so the one thing you do have to do is you have to do a strip cycle every few weeks. You have to do a strip cycle, so you have to fully charge it, fully discharge it. So that's where the fancy software comes in. The aim of the software is to work around your schedule, learn your schedule, and think of the best way to do that strip cycle every 2, 3, 4 weeks, whenever it is. So there's a lot of challenges. As you can see at the top there, they've put it in a fancy box, so it actually doesn't look like a piece of industrial equipment. But it's a really, really nice, interesting, completely lateral thinking solution to home energy storage, and it makes a lot of sense. It's the other really nice thing about it is it's zinc bromide is actually a flame retardant, so it's horribly toxic, but it's not going to catch fire. It is refillable, so after 10 years, you can basically refill the electrode and refurbish some pumps, and you've got a brand new battery. So environmentally, although the electrolyte is toxic, if you look after that, if you look after the life cycle of that electrolyte well, the rest of it is reusable. It's not going to go to landfill, you're going to reuse it. So it's a really, really interesting, really, really interesting solution. Yes, absolutely. Two disadvantages of this is A, the toxic, the electrolyte's nasty, if it spills, it's not good, you don't want to touch it, so you don't want your cat licking it off the floor. So bear in mind you've got a tank full of nasty chemicals in your house. The other thing is the round trip efficiency, so that's the efficiency of the energy going in to the energy coming out is probably around 80%, so you're losing 20% of your energy just by putting it in the battery and then So that's a disadvantage too. A good, like the Tesla will have a 95% round trip efficiency. So, hi. I'll get to that. I've got a big table with all the numbers on. You can take that off grid, yeah. That's a really good question. You'll have two. I don't think you'd ever install less than two. They have thought about that with the inverter they use at the moment is a Victron, and they've thought about how to power it up from off grid and the grid's not there. The last one's a saltwater battery. This one's interesting. The most dangerous chemical in there is saltwater, so that's good. 100% depth of discharge, doesn't degrade, so it's very similar to the red flow in that respect. Except it hasn't got the really nasty electrolyte. It's actually bigger than the, it's actually a lot bigger than the spray flow. So this one is kind of that square and about that high, and that's for 2.7 kilowatt hours. So if you wanted 10 kilowatt hours, you'd be from here to kind of here and this high. So it's a big old battery. The other major disadvantage of it is it's very low power. So each one of those stacks is only about 300 watts, I think. I've got the numbers on the table. So it's good for energy, not so good for power, unless you have lots and lots of them, because those powers will add. So that's an interesting one, salt water. So that's all your battery types at the moment that are available on the Australian market anyway. While we're on it. So what we've developed at Solar Quotes is we keep this table up to date. So this is a battery comparison table. If you go to our website, it's in the footer of the homepage. This is all the battery solutions, home battery solutions we can find on the Australian market, along with all their specifications and costs. So we start, we've got, you can have a look at this in your own time, but we've got the LG Chem, which is about the same size as the Tesla Powerwall. It's about 6.4 kilowatt hours nominal. That cost of that, this is a retail cost, it's about $7,500 for the main pack with 6.4 kilowatt hours. The Z cell, just the battery, 10 kilowatt hours, is about $12,600. These things aren't cheap. The Tesla Powerwall retail is about $8,000 just for the battery. Let's go to the aqueous, the saltwater battery is $2,500 a stack, but that's only 2.2 kilowatt hours, and the power is 260 watt per battery, so really, really low power. So if you want to see all your battery options on the market, this table is the most, as far as I'm aware, the most comprehensive comparison online. We've got a lot of Americans actually using it as well. So I'll come back to this table in a sec. So should you buy batteries? Well, it depends on your reason for buying batteries. If your reasons are environmental at the moment, in my humble opinion, it's crazy to buy batteries if you're connected to the grid. So I'm going to assume that you've got a home that's connected to the grid. If you've currently got solar, you're exporting it. You're probably exporting quite a lot to the grid. You're probably getting paid 8 to 12 cents in South Australia. Kilowatt hour, and that pisses off a lot of people because they're paying 30 cents plus, 28 cents plus. But all that solar energy that you're exporting to the grid is doing an amazing amount of good work in terms of offsetting CO2. So, I mean, the South Australian grid's pretty good, right? It's 45% renewables or something. Still, every kilowatt hour that you export to the grid, even though you're getting paid a pittance for it, but we're not talking about economics at the moment, we're talking about CO2 emissions essentially, is offsetting, you know, grid electricity, which is dirtier than the solar you're generating. So if you buy a battery and minimize your grid outputs and then start putting all your kilowatt hours through this battery, you've just added the embodied energy in the battery to the CO2 footprint of your electricity generation. So you're actually making your electricity dirtier. I mean, let's be honest, most of these batteries, yes, Elon Musk is building a gigafactory, good on him, that will be mostly renewable powered, 100% renewable powered. But most battery factories in the world are in China, or almost all of them are in China. And they're powered by, you know, a very, very dirty grid. It takes, best estimates I can find online are it takes 400 kilowatt hours to manufacture 1 kilowatt hour of that. So, at the end of the day, if you're putting your electricity, if instead of exporting your electricity directly to the grid and offsetting some grid power, you're putting it through a battery, you're making your nice clean solar energy quite dirty at the moment in 2016. So there's no real green reason to buy a battery at the moment, apart from to support the development of batteries as an early adopter. Yes. After you've discharged 400 kilowatt hours, if every kilowatt hour was saving a kilowatt hour of coal-fired electricity, you'd be ahead. But it depends on how you're using it. If you're not connected to the grid, it might be. If you're off grid, it might be. And the alternative is a diesel generator, you might be. So it depends on your use case. But someone who's connected to the grid says, I don't want to export my power to the greedy electricity companies because I'm getting paid a pittance. That's fine, but that's an economic reason, not a green reason. These are big boxes generally full of toxic chemicals that are generally made in very dirty factories in China, so bear that in mind. Economic reasons, should you buy batteries for economic reasons? If you're connected, again, it depends on your use case, but for the average user connected to the grid, let's have a look at the economics. So we'll go back to this table. So in my opinion, the best way to evaluate the cost of a battery is to look at how many kilowatt hours of storage the manufacturer will warrant. So again, there's this implied warranty thing. And a lot of the American manufacturers haven't realized that Australia's got an implied warranty law. So for example, Elon Musk stood on stage a year and a half ago and said, this is a 7 kilowatt hour battery. He essentially implied you'd get 7 kilowatt hours of storage for 10 years. In fact, he went further than that. He said, this is a 15-year battery. It's a 7 kilowatt hour battery. So a lot of us, we had a back of our napkins, we were doing the math, 7 kilowatt hours times 365 days by 15 years. Well, wow, that's like 20 cents a kilowatt hour to store stuff. That's starting to make sense. Unfortunately, when the warranty document came out a couple of months ago, it's nothing like that. So, A, it's warranted for 10 years, which is fine, but the amount of cycles it's warranted for, well, I'll get to that in a minute. I'll show you a picture I drew from the warranty document. So you can't really look at the battery nominal storage capacity, look at the amount of cycles, multiply the two together and say, this is how many kilowatt hours I'll get out of the battery before the warranty is expired. Because there's lots of stuff in the warranty document generally that massively reduce this warranty kilowatt hours. So the best way to work out how much a battery is going to cost you to use, in my opinion, is to look through the warranty document, see how many kilowatt hours they really do warrant, taking into account degradation, divide the cost by that, and that is your cost to store a kilowatt hour of energy in the battery. So on this table, we've done that, where warranty documents are available. Where warranty documents aren't available, we've just gone off the specifications on the specification sheet. And the big disclaimer there is when the warranty document does come out, it'll probably be a lot worse. But when you go through and you do that, the Tesla Powerwall, for example, the third column there, works out just for the battery, it works out at 50 cents. This is all Australian. 50 cents Australian to store a kilowatt hour of energy. So the economic case in South Australia for storing your solar energy, say you get paid 8 cents, you offset about 28 cents, you're saving about 20 cents a kilowatt hour. So essentially, if you buy a Powerwall battery, just the battery is going to be spending 50 cents to save 20. Hi. Yes? People that are getting 44. Well, you want to export as much as possible. They'd be better off using the washing machine when the sun's not shining. You're not wasting all of it, you're wasting the difference between what you get paid what you could offset from what you're paying. So it, you know, that's about 20 cents. You generally, you can easy, quite very easily in South Australia get 8 cents. You get 12 cents if you go to Wick Energy, I think. Although their usage rates aren't great, but you can get 10 cents of Diamond Energy. But, so if you're getting, but let's say it's 8 cents. If you're getting 8 cents and you're paying 28 cents, you're saving 20 cents if you use your own solar electricity. The difference between what you pay for electricity and what you get paid for it. If you're on a 44 cent tariff, then it make, you want to maximize your exports. So you'd actually lose money by using battery. Because you'd be saving 28 cents instead of making 44 cents. So yeah, then it really doesn't make economic sense. So yeah, the people that might think it might make economic sense are the people that are getting a low feed-in tariff, which is about 8 cents in South Australia. So that 50 cents to buy the Tesla Powerwall before the warranty is up, and generally with batteries, we're pretty confident that they won't last much longer than the warranty. It's not like a car where, you know, the car doesn't fall to bits after the 3-year manufacturer's warranty expires, but a battery is unlikely to be performing very well after the manufacturer's warranty, especially when it's a 10-year warranty, which is very, very long for a battery in historical terms. I mean, I don't know if anyone's got a laptop where the lithium-ion battery lasted 10 years. Probably not. So the interesting thing about the Powerwall is that's just for the battery. If you want to get a battery inverter, like you need to get SolarEdge or a Fronius or an SMA that's coming out soon, that's cost per kilowatt hour of storage is actually goes up to 75 cents. So you're paying 75 cents for every kilowatt hour of storage you use over the lifetime of the battery, the warranted lifetime of the battery, to save 20 cents. So it does not make economic sense for most people. There are some really strange situations where you're on really odd tariffs, really extreme tariffs, where it might make sense, but for most people, no. So that's the Powerwall. So if we go across this bottom row, we can see the cost per warranted kilowatt hour for all the batteries. The winner is actually the Redflow. That's 42 cents. So that's warranted for 10 years or 3,000 cycles. And it's guaranteed to be 10 kilowatt hours across that entire warranty range. So that's 30,000 kilowatt hours, 30 megawatt hours of storage you're warranted to get. If you divide the price by the warranted kilowatt hours, it works out 42 cents a kilowatt hour. That does not include the inverter. No, I haven't. It's a good point. That is an Achilles heel of the Redflow. One interesting thing that makes it not quite a fair comparison with the Powerwall is because it's an electromechanical system, you can decouple the input efficiency from the output efficiency. With a chemical battery, it's generally 50% on the input, 50% on the output, I think. Whereas with the Redflow, they tell me, and I don't know how much of this is wishful thinking, but they tell me the majority of that is on the input. And their logic is, they justify that by saying, well, solar panels are cheap, stick some more solar panels on your roof. Storage is expensive, solar panels are cheap. But they, when I ask them to break down what percentage of that 20% loss is on the input compared to the output, they can't tell me. But no, that number doesn't include the 80%, so that's a good point. Yes, it would. Yeah, absolutely it would. And we do have we've got a lot of numbers in this table, and one of them is the round trip efficiency up here. So you could actually just, you'll be able to export this to Excel soon. Our programmer's just doing that, and then you could just multiply the two together, which is a very good idea, actually. Yeah, that would be really interesting, actually. But you can see, so basically the best price you can get for battery only is about, you know, 40 cents. As you go along the table, it can vary considerably. 67 cents, $1.33, $1.70. Bearing in mind the economics in South Australia is to save 20 cents a kilowatt hour. $1.61. 48 cents for the N-phase AC battery. That's an interesting one. So the N-phase AC battery, I'm probably going to buy a battery for my house just because I think I should experience owning a battery. And I think I'm going to get an Enphase AC battery, mainly because it's only 1.2 kilowatt hour, so it's quite cheap. And also it doesn't need its own battery inverter, so for the it's actually, for the first battery, it says 2,000 fully installed. We should change this to say 3,000 fully installed for the first one, and then 2,000 for subsequent ones. And because the first one, you've got to install an interface unit. So this is a battery with a microinverter in the box. In that box is basically a lithium-ion battery and a microinverter. So that can essentially plug straight into your 240 volt circuit on your house via a thing called an envoy, which is a communication sub. And then if you decide you want more batteries, you can almost literally plug and play the next one in. So that's a really interesting take on the battery thing. Instead of getting one big battery, you can get a teeny tiny battery, see how you go. If you're really sensible, you'll measure your return on that and decide if you want the next one. And all the analysis that I've seen done says the first kilowatt hour of storage gives you the best return, so it might actually make a lot of sense to do that. That's a really good point. I'll get to that. I'll get to that, yeah. How are we doing for time? Okay. So just in terms of cost, let's just have a look at the saltwater one, because that's a really interesting one. So that, yeah, saltwater one comes at about 63 cents, so about 50% more than the red flow at the moment. So back to the reason I went to that table was, should you buy batteries for economic reasons? Not if you've got a grid-connected solar system and you're looking to reduce your export or reduce your imports or both. What about if you want backup? So that is another reason to get batteries is backup. If you really need backup, you've probably already got a generator. If you haven't already got a generator, you probably don't need backup. If you want to replace your generator with the batteries, I think that's excellent, because you need the generator for a lot. It pollutes. In particular, and CO2 emissions, so that can be a very good reason to get batteries. Therefore. Yes, so I'll talk about that now, yes. So if you choose not to buy batteries right now, based on the economics or the green side of it, or you don't really need backup, then bear in mind that it's not all doom and gloom about batteries. In fact, it's very exciting. In the next 50 years? In the next 5 years, they're projected to drop in price 3 to 4 times. So suddenly those numbers start to make a lot of sense. So if a lithium-ion battery goes from 75 cents a kilowatt hour, including battery inverter per kilowatt hour of storage, down to 25 cents, you're starting to break even. And by then, electricity prices will have probably risen quite a lot as well. So, yeah, I think we're looking at about 5 years before batteries start to make economic sense for most people. So in the meantime, what do you do if you don't want to buy batteries right now? Well, if you haven't got a solar system, I think you buy a battery-ready solar system. That makes a lot of sense. But what does battery ready actually mean? And that's a really good point. So there's our friends at True Value Solar, not a company I'm a fan of, advertising battery ready solar systems. Essentially what they're advertising is, if you imagine this picture without the right hand side on, they're just advertising normal solar systems. And they are battery ready, they're technically correct, they are battery ready, because you can add the box on the right hand side, the battery inverter, do a thing called AC coupling, which is you're connecting it in on the 240 volt wires essentially, and then you connect a battery to the battery inverter, and your solar system has got batteries. So battery ready, if you want to look at it like that, all solar systems are battery ready, because you can simply AC couple a battery inverter and a battery into pretty much any solar system. So do be careful if you see solar systems that are advertised as battery ready. You want to, and I'll go into the other types of battery ready in a minute. They may just be a normal solar system. And as long as the sales company is transparent about that, that's fine, because they are technically battery ready. here's the problem with systems like that. They're very hard to add backup to. And that's because the two red boxes won't be able to talk to each other. Now, why is that an issue? First thing you've got to decide is, do you want backup? If you don't want backup, and there's lots of people who don't need backup, especially in South Australia, where we do have a generally very reliable grid, then just having a battery inverter that AC couples into your existing solar system can be a good solution. It's an easy solution to implement, because if there's any excess electricity, if you look at that diagram, you know, once your batteries are full and your house is using all the solar energy it can, any excess energy is just going to go out to the grid. So it's a very robust system. It's fairly easy to configure. The grid is just this giant infinite battery that just soaks up any excess and makes up for any shortfall. If you want backup, it's a completely different solution. So you'll see there we've got a very, very, very simplified, but we've got a switch. As soon as you open that switch, if you've got any excess solar, and the battery's full and the house is using everything it can, that's got nowhere to go. So what needs to happen is the battery inverter, which is the box on the right, needs to talk to the solar inverter and say, oi, throttle back your solar please, because there's nowhere for it to go. So to do that, you need a compatible solar inverter and battery inverter. So if you want a battery-ready system that is ready for batteries and you want backup, you have to be fairly careful about what solar inverter you specify. It has to have a communications protocol that is going to be compatible with battery inverters, and many of the battery inverters haven't been out on the market yet. So luckily there are standards, and the main one is Modbus. That seems to be the main standard for solar inverters to talk to battery inverters. So if you're buying a solar system and you want batteries with backup, make sure you get an inverter that has Modbus communication. The other alternative is, and this is a truly battery-ready system if you like, one that you can simply just put batteries into and batteries come out at the right price, is you get a thing called a hybrid inverter. And that's essentially the two red boxes combined in one unit. There's some fairly nice ones coming out of China at the moment, and they're actually fairly cheap in terms compared to a standard 5 kilowatt hybrid inverter. Is Chinese one is fairly close in price to a kind of a premium non-hybrid German inverter and SMAO furnace. So if you want to just be able to plug batteries in the future, then you go for a hybrid inverter. Whether that's a good idea is a moot point, because in 5 years' time, I imagine battery inverters will be much, much, much cheaper, as well as batteries being much cheaper. So it's probably going to be cheaper just to get a solar inverter that speaks Modbus and buy everything in 5 years' time. So if you're buying a solar system now and you want it to be battery compatible, the main thing to take away is decide whether you want backup in the future or not. If you do, either get a hybrid inverter that does backup, not all hybrid inverters do, or get a premium solar inverter that has a Modbus interface, would be my advice. And also be aware that a hybrid system, so we call it a hybrid system if it's got batteries and it's connected to the grid with backup, is a lot more complicated to install than one that doesn't have backup. Essentially, you've got to rewire the house, because as you were asking, Alan, you've got to put the non-essential loads on one circuit and the essential loads on the other circuit. So the essential loads are the loads that the battery will supply when you're not connected to the grid. If you don't do that, you need an enormous battery bank to power everything in the house, including the air conditioner, the whole water system. Generally, you want to think about which loads you want to be backed up and put those on a separate circuit. So there's a fair amount of rewiring, probably, if you don't even have to. Yep. It has to for safety reasons, otherwise there's nothing to stop it sending the electricity back onto the grid. When the guys come to fix the grid, they'll get a shock. Everything keeps going, yes, but you need batteries to do that, and you need the battery inverter to sort of solar inverter, so if there's excess solar energy, it gets throttled back. Because there's a switch that stops the the switch opens, so no electricity can go to the grid. And that's a very, there's very specific standards around that switch, so it's not going to accidentally be left. It's very unlikely to be accidentally left closed or fail closed, should I say. If you haven't got batteries, there are some inverters that will disconnect from the grid and still let you to use your solar power if you've got enough sun. Power router does that. I don't think you can still buy that if you achieve. Some of the Sunny, I don't think the SMA ones came out in this country, but in America you could get a Sunny Boy SMA inverter with a special power point on it, and if the grid went down you could plug things into the power point and get enough sun. But it becomes very expensive very quickly when you've got a fabulous, when you've got to disconnect from the grid and put all the monitoring power electronics around that to make sure it doesn't connect back up to the grid. That's the grid work. And make sure, and just managing the amount of electricity when you've got all this solar coming in is absolutely. So what's missing off this diagram is, if you imagine the battery inverter has a little meter on it, and that connects to the cable going into your electricity meter. And so the battery inverter knows at any one time whether you're importing electricity from the grid or exporting electricity. It also knows how much solar you're generating. So those battery inverters, you can program them to behave as you want them to, but generally they'll use your battery before you use the grid. They'll only charge the battery with solar and won't charge it with the grid. So it depends how big your battery is, depends how big your power is, how much you're going to get that day. Yeah. No, so your system would be configured to drain your home battery into your car battery if there wasn't any solar. But you know, generally your cars have got a 60 kilowatt hour battery, you probably have a 10 kilowatt hour home battery. So yeah, you don't, if you're doing any decent amount of driving, you don't use an average size home battery. So battery economics, I've kind of gone over this. So basically you're spending 50 cents to $1.50 per kilowatt hour stored of warranted storage to save 20 cents a kilowatt hour. Doesn't really make sense at the moment. The battery comparison table's there. And the end phase AC battery, yeah, about $3,000 fully installed for your first battery. So if you do want a battery, and you know, if you're a bit of a geek like me and you just want to play with a battery and see what happens, that's quite a relatively affordable way to jump into the batteries. And then if you, the batteries really turn you on and you want to add more, then almost literally plug and play apparently for the subsequent ones. And they're coming out in the next month. The end phase AC. 1.2. Yeah, so that's Enphase make microinverters, and they've literally pretty much taken a microinverter and slapped it on top of the battery. So that's a 250 watt inverter. So that's one of the disadvantages of that battery is it can only charge and discharge at 250 watts. So it's going to take maybe five hours to discharge. That, you know, if you've got a big spike in power, it's only going to take a tiny bit off. Yeah, so if you have 10 of those batteries, it'll be 2,600 watts. Yeah. For my use case at home, I use about 3 kilowatt hours at night, so I can just charge the battery. Yeah, save half that. Sorry? They do it for them. Why? They're going to thermal runaway. I'm not an expert on these things, but once they get above a certain temperature, it's positive feedback loop. Yeah, generally, they don't. So there was a grow watt one that exploded. There was a picture of it that's been doing the rounds. Apparently the inverter, the rumour is that the battery inverter was on lead acid mode. Of lithium ion mode, so charge the thing in the wrong way and that's how it exploded. But I'd argue that if it was a good lithium ion battery and a good lithium ion battery management system, it wouldn't allow itself to be treated in that way. You know what I mean? That's not the look of the other. We pause it. Yes. Yes. That's all systems go. Those guys, that technology is amazing. Yes, so that makes the economics a bit better. You're looking at, it's really hard to predict what, well, it's impossible to predict what your return will be. So they don't like to, because they can get into trouble. For a ballpark, you know, maybe if you've got a 7 kWh battery, you're looking at maybe $500 a year extra. And that's probably being very, very ambitious. So yeah, you can work that into the payback. So I guess if you've got, it's about $10,000 for a 7 kWh wall plus battery inverter installed. So you're saving, you know, at $500 a year to pay back, it's still not going to pay for itself for a while. It might just pay for itself when the warranty's up, but that's making loads of assumptions about how much deposit's going to give you every year, which is impossible to do. Yeah, it's definitely a good idea. The deposit's really, really interesting. For the deposit, power is more valuable than energy, so you need a power. It's all about grid support, so you want to be pumping out loads of power for short periods of time. That's how you get the real value. That's what the grid wants. So you need a powerful battery. So the Powerwall's only 3 kW. Really, when I was talking to those guys, they were talking, you want at least a 10 kW, 15 kW battery to be really valuable. So I don't know how that's going. I think they're waiting for much cheaper, much more powerful batteries. I'm talking about a service called Reposit Power. So if you buy a battery today, you can buy an add-on controller called a Reposit Controller, and that connects to the internet, and that essentially allows you to kind of trade your electricity on the wholesale electricity market. It's another income stream for battery owners. So basically, when the grid's struggling and it needs power, it empties your battery into the grid. Which one battery is going to make no difference, but the, you know, the long-term vision is if you've got a million of these batteries, it's going to actually make a big difference. And the grid will, they've got relationships with the energy retailers where they will pay you for that electricity at a premium rate. So the deal at the moment is when there's what they call it, a grid credits event, which is when there's really high demand for electricity and low supply, you get $1 per kilowatt hour. But that doesn't happen very often. No, I don't think there is. And I personally don't think there is. I can't see how it is. So don't get me wrong. Batteries have got an enormous part to play in integrating renewables into the grid. But in my opinion, at the moment, for the next 5 years, until batteries become more affordable, that's best done on a grid level. Big banks of batteries that are designed for grid support that will help. It's, you know, the more renewables, the better, right? So when we start running into problems with grid stability, then let's start deploying these huge banks of grid-scale batteries to stabilize the grid, and also in microgrids. You know, microgrids can make a lot of sense, and batteries can make a difference between a microgrid working on renewables being viable or not, and that's brilliant. You know, that's absolutely brilliant. That's a really good application for batteries. But on an individual level, connected to the grid, you've got solar system connected to the grid, they don't really make sense. They don't make economic or environmental sense right now, looking at it at that individual level, in my opinion. Now we've got a microgrid expert in this one. Here we go. Well, we've got a microgrid that's up and running, working well.
I have a microgrid question. Just a microgrid. There's some kind of seat here. And
batteries combined with solar and batteries combined with solar can offset a lot of diesel, and that's a really big bang for your buck in terms of cost and, you know, particulate emissions and CO2 emissions. That's where they really should be deploying them right now, in my opinion. It's nuts to, in this day and age, to be generating so much electricity from diesel. Yes. That shoebox, big shoebox. So just an example of the Tesla is the famous one. So Elon Musk said it was a 7 kWh battery would last 15 years. When the warranty document came out, they called it a 6.4 kWh battery that would last 10 years. When you actually look at the warranty document, this is what they actually warrant. So they call it a 6.4 kilowatt hour battery. They only warrant 5.4 kilowatt hours for the first 2 years. That's the green part. Then it degrades, all lithium ion degrades. Then it degrades to 4.6 kilowatt hours for the next 3 years. Then for the last 5 years of the $10,000 battery, they're only warranting 3.8 kilowatt hours out of your 6.4 kilowatt hour battery. So bear that in mind when you're buying batteries. Look at the warranty document, see what they're actually warranting. Because that's pretty much all you can hold them to. That's one cycle a day.
If it doesn't need to cycle a day, that gives it a good extra life. So if you're sunny day, you're getting mercy power from solar panels, and so on, it'll do something different.
Yeah, then it'll last a lot longer, yeah. Yeah, but most possible. A lot of Australians are looking at stuff like the Powerwall as a sledgehammer to crack the nuts of a very energy efficient house, which will pull a lot more than, you know, 5.4 kilowatt hours, 4.6 or 3.8 kilowatt hours overnight. They'll be pulling 15 kilowatt hours overnight. So they'll be draining that thing every night, the average resident house. I mean, in here, I think we've probably all got fairly efficient houses. One of the things I came away with, I went to the solar conference a couple of weeks ago, was we've got to be very careful not to see batteries as a magic bullet and forget about energy efficiency and just, you know, well-sized solar, which can get your bills down 80%. We should look at batteries just maybe for the last 20%. Now that I've got an 8-cent feeding tariff, my last electricity bill was $11, and I haven't got batteries. So we've got to be careful that we don't just buy more stuff to try and solve a problem, which is kind of consuming less and being much smarter about what we do consume. Yes? I think it's more depth of discharge than rate of discharge. Yeah, as long as you don't go, you know, well, they won't let you go over what their nominal. Well, they will. They'll have a nominal power output and a instantaneous power output, which you can hold for whatever the state says, 5 minutes. I think it's, but they're much harder to kill like that. I don't think so. And. Yeah, I think most people here are quite keen on the environmental side of things. The best battery available in Australia right now, that in terms of environmental benefit, is the grid and paying an extra, you know, 5 cents a kilowatt hour for your electricity to get green power. You've got an infinite battery connected to your house. If you pay for green power, you're guaranteed that that's going to come from renewable sources that will top up your house with green power when you haven't generated it, and it will soak up your excess. So. Don't forget the grid, although it is owned by pretty horrible companies and pretty horrible people. It's a wonderful thing, and it's been built, and you can pay extra for green power through there. Yes? Hi.
Yes. Is there a general rule of thumb about the different sorts of batteries between the size of the solar array and the size of the battery storage? Is there some sort of general relationship?
So it's really going to depend on use case. Bear in mind, so there's all sorts of spreadsheets bouncing around. The ATA's got one actually, I think, the simulator. Yeah, so you can, if you Google simulator, you'll get the ATA's, I think it's a downloadable Excel spreadsheet, and you can play around. I mean, generally, you're going to want at least 5 kilowatts on your roof, you know, a 7 kilowatt hour battery, which is the kind of size of batteries that are coming out. And especially bear in mind that in winter, you're going to get half the power compared to summer, you're still going to need charge a battery. So as a really, really, really rough rule of thumb, you know, you probably want at least 5-6 kilowatts on your roof, charge a 7 kilowatt hour battery.
You mentioned that there in the different batteries.
Yes.
Different power output, different batteries.
Yes.
Does that matter so much? Would you make a general comment about how much that might matter in terms of the average power requirement?
Totally depends how you're going to use a battery. So, you know, what's it going to be offsetting? Is it going to be offsetting? Do you want it to offset heat from your air conditioner or heat from a wall pump that's going to peak at 2 or 3 kilowatts? Do, then yeah, you probably want to think about power. It depends on the usage profile of your house. Generally, the spikes that are really short use very little energy anyway. If you want to use it for grid support, if you want to maximize, you know, if you want to buy something like deposit power and maximize your output, yeah, you can get more power there. It depends on the usage profile of your house.
In South Australia, SA Power's Australian energy regulators, moving over the next 5 years to power and an energy charge component. And that's one of the things that I think is hard to calculate when you're trying to advise what to do. And it's also not clear what the economics of it is yet. But that's one of the main concerns we've got when we're looking at what batteries to provide.
Reduce the big demand.
Yeah, is that given that volume of energy, even though at the moment it's insignificant, it's sort of been, they've been given the yes that the change is going to happen, so eventually it will stick, and it will be in that five, it's probably, you know, 4 to 5 years away at most.
So is that, if they hit the peak power for 5 seconds, they're going to get hammered with a peak amount of power?
I think it's an average over a 15-second interval. Is that half 30 minutes?
Half an hour, so peak demand between 4 and 9 in summer.
Yeah.
So that's where the batteries might come into it. If you can cut your peak demand from 4 to 9, that's where you, and if they charge you 56 kilowatts of that, that's what
absolutely, yeah. So that, the networks in their rush to kind of gouge is, you know, make the business case of batteries better and better, probably. But I mean, you're going to have to be ready. That's going to have to be a crash hot design to make sure you get all those peaks if you miss one.
This gets back to having an energy efficient home, doesn't it? You're not requiring a high energy use to be an air conditioner.
The thing I took away from this, the most recent solar conference a couple of weeks ago, was no one was talking about efficiency, very few people were talking about solar, everyone was talking about batteries. An efficient home combined with a nice, you know, decent sized solar system is going to get you tiny bills. Energy negative home. It's not that difficult. You concentrate on the film and work at your home. Efficient appliances. Better off spending $2,000 on a super efficient clothes dryer if you need it a lot than $10,000 on a 7 kilowatt hour battery. And probably get the bills down more.
At the moment, water infrastructure is considered an essential service and it's a supply charge which you pay even if you don't have water.
Yep.
Could you see that coming for electricity?
Yeah, absolutely, and they want to do that. I spoke to guys from the Australian Energy Regulator, and that's where they want to go. They want to charge you whether you're connected to the grid or not, the poles that pass your house. So whether they'll get away with it, that's another.
Those figures you showed for the heads and the one, is that systems that they are shipping currently in Australia, or is it for once the gigafactory is producing their own?
That's the current model. It's on the market now. They're announcing a Powerwall 2 in the next 2 months. So maybe that will be new. But I think that's a fundamental characteristic of the batteries they used. I mean, the batteries they used in Powerwall are exactly the same as the batteries they used in the car.
You're talking about solar panels.
Yeah.
Getting away from batteries. Do you use solar panels in coming down another one in the last few years? Do you see that reduction in price continuing, or are you sort of reaching a bottom on it?
No, I think it's going down all the time. You look at all the developments that are coming out of the lab, there's amazing stuff going on. I did say I was going to say the best way to buy a battery in 2016. Honestly, I think it's the best thing you can do if you want to join the battery revolution and save CO2. And I'm not being facetious, honestly. Batteries are most valuable environmental wise if they replace petrol. It's a direct, especially if you're charging them from solar. And even better than that, the thing on the right is a specialised turbo. That's a $3,000 electric bike, and it is the best one you'll ever have. They are awesome. They're absolutely awesome. So if you can, if you can replace driving around in your car with an electric bike, A, you'll have a lot more fun, and B, you'll be directly offset, not emitting CO2 emissions and particulate emissions. So, what I'm thinking of buying an Enphase battery for $3,000, I could get a specialised turbo for that, a lot more fun. And it would save a lot more CO2. That's from car sales today. You can get a really, really nice little electric car for $20,000, and they're really quite cheap second hand with almost no mileage. So that's the price of 2 Powerwall, and it will last longer probably. Yep. The Adelaide City rebate. Are you talking about? Which rebate?
Let's say you've got a tonic.
Yep.
You're getting 44%.
Oh, feeding tariff.
Feeding tariff, sorry, yeah.
Well, I say power networks say that you'll lose your feeding tariff if you get batteries, is that right? Is that still the case?
Yeah.
So as soon as you can get that in, you'll lose your feeding tariff.
You'll lose your feeding tariff, yep.
So that's, that's
what about if you're on that? So if you lose, you put the batteries on, you lose your feeding tariff. If you're on 7 cents feeding tariff, that doesn't make much difference, maybe.
I export a shed load of electricity, so I've got a really good house in the system. It depends on that situation.
At 7 cents, you think?
8 cents. Yeah. But yeah, so that's another culture. Do you have batteries in South Australia?
Best prospect in new battery technology, which is not currently available in Australia, and might be coming up like Zingier or something like that.
Solar panels feeding into the house. red battery inverters. I've been around for many years. I installed some back in the late 90s, and they were inverters will keep going and run the house. Once the grid goes down, they'll automatically switch over and run the house, and the grid comes back on. The contact is where they switch back automatically. And they're still around as a hybrid, solid grid battery inverter.
Yep.
I don't know if you're familiar
with
that brand.
Yeah, there's a new market that will do that. Mm-hmm. They're fairly expensive. Yeah, they need to be very carefully installed, and you need to think about essential loads and non-essential loads. Yeah,
it's all built into them. They do the whole lot.
It's totally possible. Yeah, you just kind of care about it. Yeah.
Lithium-ion batteries and lithium-ion batteries, different types
of.
And of course, you didn't specifically say that in the talk, but you made a list of different types of lithium-ion batteries that you can use in the table.
Yes.
Some are safer than others.
Yes, absolutely.
Would you like to talk about that?
I'm not an expert, but I believe the lithium-ion polymer are a lot safer than standard lithium-ion. I think the bonding pouches are a lot safer. I think physically separated.
I think an important point on your table is that maybe 6 out of 10 of the lithium ions are lithium ion phosphate.
Yes.
So businesses have moved to that as a likely safer.
Yes.
Place.
Yes. I'm not an expert on how safe they are. I think for an Australian standard, says. I don't know if it discriminates between lithium ion and lithium ion phosphate.
Do you recall the old nickel ion battery? It used to be a totally recyclable battery too. Do I have a totally recyclable nickel ion?
Yeah.
NIP.
Yeah.
Are they still around?
They are around. Yeah.
Are they viable?
I think they are a red.
cars, two electric cars
with
all the batteries.
Yeah, that's cool. There's just about no batteries in these days. But I think it's possible to convert it. It's fun. It's a lot of things to do. How hard is it? I think it's the electric car club guys here.
Hello, hello. Let me just pull this one up. It was dropped on the desktop for me, apparently. There she is. So, hello, my name's Sean Zeppel. I'm sort of indirectly involved here with ATA. I'm doing a lot of the video stuff here, so some of that will be available later. Essentially, I'm bringing a little mini presentation here because I've been in touch with a man, Matt, who has decided to drive his Tesla Model S from Perth to Brisbane, which some people would think it's number one impossible or crazy. He's the second person to attempt it successfully as well, but he's the first who is actually doing it in what we would consider a reasonable time. So the previous person that attempted the Nullarbor trip did about 50 kilometers an hour to get maximum range out of the battery, which is good on them, but not really all that practical. So you and I are not going to spend 2 weeks Matt and Dave spent 6 months planning this trip, contacting roadhouses, councils, anyone they could at the approximate distances to identify whether there were three-phase charging outlets or 15-amp charging outlets or whether they could get charging outlets installed. A lot of councils said, what? Who? What's an electric vehicle? Others said, yeah, we've got heaps, come along. And of course, them saying heaps and actually understanding what infrastructure they have are two different things as well. So they haven't necessarily got everything that they were promised at certain locations, but certainly improved it. So Matt, yeah, named his little trip Nullus Arbor Unum Tesla, which is zero trees, one Tesla. Quite clever. The premise was literally Perth to Brisbane and back again in his Tesla Model S, which he's had for about a year, so 2015. Late 2014 model. It said 6 months of planning, not the first, but first doing it. They've added some live tracking to the vehicle, so this trip is actually going on at the moment, so you'll be able to track them live at the moment. He's up in Sydney, tomorrow he leaves up towards Brisbane, and then he's going to come all the way back through Adelaide again. I caught up with him last weekend when he was passing through Adelaide. I'll catch up with him again early June when they're on their way back through here. And yeah, the biggest win has been the education to a lot of these remote communities that, hey, look, these things are coming, you might want to look at adding charging stations. As some people are aware and some are not, charging electric vehicle at home, easy, because you buy the vehicle, you get the charging pack, get it installed, not a problem. Our internal combustion engine vehicles, we just drive to the petrol station, there's one nozzle that size for petrol, one that's this size for diesel, works everywhere, no problem, LPG, similar. Charging electric vehicle, there isn't quite the perfect standard for each electric vehicle still. The charge port that's on the iMeeV is slightly different to the Tesla to this, so Matt had to come up with, he has 10 different adapters in total, to be able to fit 32 amp three phase, 50 amp three phase, 15 amp sockets, 10 amp sockets, the that the iMeevs use to basically make every single adapter possible so that no matter what location he came up to, he would be able to plug into the electricity, because we all know you can get the juice, but you've got to have the right connector. So that was certainly one of the big challenges. And something else that they pre-thought of, thankfully, but just because you have a 32 amp three-phase socket on the wall doesn't mean the wiring behind it can sustain 32 amps of electricity. So something that is going to become a big problem, I believe, in a lot of places is that everyone goes, yeah, the adapter's on the wall, you're sweet, but it's got 20 amp wiring or something behind it. So they brought along a variable current adapter so they could actually down what they're able to pull from a socket if, because the Teslas have a variable charge rate, so they'll actually work their way up rather than starting at 20 amps and coming down. So it would quickly tell them if the socket was not actually capable of 32 or 50 amps, etc. So that's going to be a problem all over the place. And of course, spare plugs, because that's your one cord that you're going to use for the 10,000 kilometer journey. If something happens to that, you're a little bit stuffed. So they had a few spares in there as well. Live tracking is available for this journey. As I said, they're in Sydney, so he's still going. They're doing two methods of tracking, one via mobile phone network and another via satellite uplink. So you can literally see in real time every 30 seconds exactly where he is, what speed he's doing, what direction he's doing, and the battery level of the car. So you get a really good, quick picture of the speeds they're doing, where they're up to in their travels. There is an itinerary, so you can sort of work out where they are between to see how low he's getting in battery level between all the positions. He has a Twitter handle, so you don't have to write this stuff down if you're happy to follow someone on Twitter. Some of the really big things I found with this trip, especially with the Tesla, is the autopilot function. So, as many of you are aware, it's got the sort of autonomous mode that can drive you along or change lanes or avoid collisions, etc. You know, the Nullarbor is not a particularly exciting trip in some spots, so it can be quite draining to continuously concentrate. So they found having this autopilot has been fantastic because they've been able to relax. So they come to the end of the trip and they're not actually tired because they've been watching the road, not holding the steering wheel, concentrating heavily, and having to rest every 2 hours. They still took two drivers, and they'll take two drivers on the way back as well because you still need to rest and have breaks, etc. But they've found that has really alleviated a lot of stress in their bodies for the journey. So that was an interesting point. But they have noted that not all of the roads in rural Australia have been good enough for the autopilot to detect the line. So they're going to report that back to Tesla. It's not like they get a lot of traffic out past the Jupiter in electric vehicles. So it's a good little test. But they found the red bitumen with white markings were fantastic. But once they crossed into the SA border, there was a lot of the light grey bitumen with white markings, and they would deteriorate, and the autopilot just disengaged because it could not tell where the road was, so they had to take over. Obviously, as they were driving in autopilot, they still had hands on steering wheel, etc., because if anything was to happen, a tumble wheel or something come out on the road, it would go, oop, object, and slam on the brakes, so they've still got to concentrate. But a little interesting points. One of the big spots, which the AVU guys will be happy. Nullarbor Roadhouse, the AVA sponsored a port at the Nullarbor Roadhouse. It's just a three-phase socket. Sent it down there, electrician installed it so they could actually go and charge. So all other electric vehicle owners, if they can make it that far, they can plug in there and charge and stay the night. Which I'll come to my next point in terms of how far they can make it. So this was one of the key adapters. So when he was here in Adelaide, for his first time since owning this car, because he lives in Perth, he got to a fast charge, a rapid start charge. So this is the Chadmo charging station down at Tonza that you can plug your little iMeebs, etc. into. And one of the other Australian Electric Vehicle members was tracking Matt, saw that he'd stopped at the Mitsubishi plant, drove down and had a chat to him. So quite cool mix of technology. You can come and catch up with the people. Then something else interesting happened in his travels. He arrived in Melbourne to find that there was someone else doing the same trip in the opposite direction in a Nissan Leaf, of all things. So somewhat of a challenge in the fact the Leaf has, what, one quarter of the range of a Tesla, if not less. So this weary traveller is carrying a generator in his boot for some of the top-ups, because a few of the travels, the Leaf just simply cannot make the distance to 300 kilometres between towns. There's just no stop, so he's camping overnight. I think in his itinerary there was two spots where he had to camp overnight and charge it off the generator, which had tested and worked fine. So interesting, at the same time, two different people, one going east-west, one going west-east. So I've got a link at the end for if people want to follow Jeff's little trip. His isn't quite as well documented because he's not as well connected with Twitter and 3D, the GPS tracking, etc. So there's a little Twitter link, because that's the shortest possible thing, but I can give it to you if you're interested in Jeff's little travels, because that's going to be a little bit more heroic given the shorter range of the vehicle. But he's going to make it. He's doing it for the New South Wales something cause as well. So it's a bit of a journey for himself. So Matt's in Sydney at the moment, still making his way up to Brisbane. So feel free to follow him on Twitter. He's posting plenty of different images to do with the challenges he's facing, as well as just the random towns and people he meets along the journey, and encouraging more people to catch up with him. So encourage you, if you're going to be over in Melbourne, Sydney, Perth, wherever, to actually catch up with him. His Twitter handle for this trip is TransOzTesla. So you can follow him and obviously tweet him directly, and he'll give you more information on how the journey's going. The tracking link's on his Twitter page, so I encourage you to look at the Twitter page rather than try and type out all of the tracking stuff. And he's a member of the Tesla Motor Club, and he's on the forum there posting some more intricate details about his trip. That's also linked in his Twitter page, so it's easy just to look up TransOzTesla, but I encourage you all to tweet him something if there's a question you have of how his journey's going, or any of the challenges he's faced with any of the ports or cables or anything else. But last I heard, he's getting some new tyres tomorrow, because the Tesla's had it after 10,000 k's of his fun driving, so that's alright, he'll have new tyres to work his way back up. Yeah? So, charging, he did tell me a little bit of information. So some of the roadhouse he stayed at, they didn't make him pay anything, because he was staying there and having a meal there, so they provided for free. Others, there was, I'm not sure what the stop was, they run entirely off diesel generators, and they were making him pay. It was either 40 or 80 cents a kilowatt to charge the thing, so high-ish, but given that they're paying for fuel and everything, run up, not too bad. He was expecting to pay at each location. He certainly wasn't attempting to do this for free, but you know, it's such a new thing for a lot of roadhouses, they sort of didn't know how to handle it. Some of the other challenges he faced were some councils guaranteed him some charging, but then there wasn't a three-phase outlet. Others, they literally found a light post on an oval and found a three-phase socket there, so plugged in. Another one they plugged into the back of a toilet block that was across the road from the council chambers, because the council chamber said, yep, you can plug in on this green box in the ground. They rocked up, and that was locked. Didn't have a key, wouldn't let him in. So they went searching, found one across the road from the council chambers. Suddenly they all came marching out and said, what are you doing? What are you doing? He said, well, here's the email. We can charge. Went, oh, where do you need to charge? This green box. Oh, that's this key. And suddenly magically became unlocked. So it's been a little bit of excitement for them as they've worked around. But there's no standard for providing electricity for electric vehicles in counting. You certainly don't go to a petrol station with a counter and just plug in and say, look, you've used 60 kilowatts. So pay up. I imagine that's going to come. Every location is very much a negotiation. Their big tip was, don't speak to the receptionist, speak to the maintenance guy, because he has half a clue of where the three-phase sockets are. I encourage you to track him and chat with him on Twitter, or just follow his little journey along. As I said, it's going on at the moment. Obviously, he's stopped at the moment charging and sleeping overnight, but tomorrow he'll be off again, so you can watch the dots appear and watch his speed and direction. To sort of support his journey just by following and chatting with him, because he's not trying to do this for any particular cause. He just wants to prove to people in general that you can actually use a reasonably ranged electric vehicle to cross the entire country. The Tesla, he's got the P85 Plus, so it's about the 500 kilometer. It's a slight performance model, so the range is slightly less, but it depends what speed you're doing, what terrain you're going across. A lot of the journeys they were doing were slightly longer than the range, but because they were elevating and coming back down with the regenerative braking, like their trip into Melbourne was slightly longer than the range, but because the last descent in is all downhill, their range didn't actually change for the last 40 kilometres because they were regeneratively braking the whole way through. Yeah, so another, this is just electric vehicles in general then, interesting point that they noted is, if you're restricted to charging on 13 amp or 10 amp sockets, you're going to gain the 50 kilometers per hour worth of sort of charge or whatever. The other option you have, if you're doing 110 kilometers an hour, is to just drop back to 100 kilometers an hour. The energy you conserve by doing that is as fast as plugging into an outlet for a 10 amp outlet. So if you are limited on time budget, which they have been because they're trying to keep to their schedule of getting to the next stop where they've got accommodation. If you know you're going to slightly run short and you're going to have to try and charge in the town beforehand, you just reduce your speed by 10 kilometres an hour because you will get the extra 30 kilometres out of your range to achieve that. Obviously, if you're going to have to drop to 50 kilometres an hour like the other person has, not real safe on an open road if there's other trucks doing 110, but just that slight energy saving is enough that you don't then need to sort of plug in every single town you stop if you're out in the middle of nowhere. Obviously, general electric vehicle users here in the city, you're not going to exceed the range for your general daily driving, so you just top up each night or at work during the day, whichever. But certainly something I hadn't considered with the energy conservation tactics, because in a petrol vehicle, you just kind of fill up, top up, as you do with country driving, you just top up at every town to ensure that if there's any sort of issues on the road and you need to detour by 80 kilometres, that's fine. But electric vehicles slightly different at the moment for the charge rate. So yeah, he's currently enjoying superchargers all the way up through Melbourne, Sydney, up through to Brisbane, because they've been installed up through there. So that's the 97 kilowatt chargers versus your 30 kilowatt you get from a three-phase outlet. So a very rapid charge. So he thoroughly enjoys going to have breakfast somewhere and just plugging it in for 20 minutes, because that will give him another 40% battery, and driving off and going to the next one, plug it in. There's plenty of superchargers there. So Tesla are completing their supercharger network in Brisbane before Adelaide, so we won't see them for a little while yet, but they are coming. But I don't expect to see them between Adelaide and Perth anytime soon, so it's not really a trip many people drive, let alone in an electric vehicle. So I can give you more information if you want to see me afterwards, but really all of it's on the Twitter page there. So you can, if you're into Twitter, you can then directly tweet him there. He'll quite happily respond, because he's doing it for a bit of the love of electric vehicles and educating various people, so he's more than happy to answer questions. So, sorry? No. So, unfortunately for us, we can't get videos or pictures while he's driving, except when he has a co-driver, but generally speaking, it's all trees and open roads, so we've seen that before. It doesn't really change if you're in an electric vehicle, a truck, or a bike. It's still a road, but the few legs where he's got a co-driver, he's been doing a bit of tweeting and pictures as they drive along, so we get a bit of in-journey excitement as such. But that's what the live tracking is for. You can see exactly where he's up to. So yeah, that's at TransOzTesla, so I encourage you to check him out. Awesome.
Hi, and Pip Fletcher, would you like to come and give us a quick overview of the art competition?
Hi. You may have heard of the Solar Art Prize. I run it for 6 years now. And the prizes are solar vouchers or solar products. Tapestry, books, drawing, painting, sculpture, and some of the sculptures are weird, but never mind. It will be open for any form of media, and there are four adults, four sections. The first is landscape and seascapes, the second, natural technologies. Is for wild and endangered fauna or flora. The third, people or portraits or statuettes. And the fourth, illustration public responsibility. And the goals, of course, are environmental and doing something for the climate. Against climate change. You may have heard about him. He won a prize once, just sitting amongst his solar panels. I changed the list of sections so to open it up to more people. They found the previous way I wrote it a bit difficult. And so one of these sections. do know are looking for people who do something for the environment, and that includes probably most of you. So if any of you have a Monday or Thursday morning free, could you get in touch with me? I happen to know an art society where they go and paint portraits, and some of them are very good artists, and you'll get paid $60 per morning. But they do book ahead. So if anyone is available to for that, please tell me and I'll give you the address and the contacts. And there are one or two entry forms there, but we can photocopy any number more if you want them. Thank you very much. I hope some of you will enter.
Thanks, Pip. Is Eric here tonight to tell us about the World of the Electric Vehicles? Anything happening in AVA? Any forthcoming meeting?
At Gilbert Street.
Yeah, thanks, Bill. Other events on Wednesday night, 6 o'clock, UniSA Foyer in Hindley Street. The Adelaide Sustainable Building Network will be having a panel discussion about the Living Building Challenge. Regenerative landscapes is a topic. Check their web page or Facebook page for details. And on Wednesday, we planned a trip to Bolivar to the wastewater plant, which is fascinating. It's, you can get all the old shit jokes out of your system, and it is well worth going. However, only about 5 people think so. So if anyone is available, it is during the day, 10 o'clock, go on for about an hour and a half. Check your emails from the ATA bulletin, or come see me afterwards if you'd like to come along. Anyone for whom this is the first ATA meeting, Catherine at the back will have some free copies of Renew magazine. And our next meeting will be third Monday of June. Dr. Martin Bolesko at the UniSA is a researcher specialising in phase change materials. We'll be talking about storage, energy storage, but thermal storage, low energy heating and cooling, and using solar PV with a heat pump to generate hot water. Should be a really interesting night. Are there any other questions? Any products that people have seen? Anything? Any energy efficient tips? Hints or wrinkles that anyone wants to share with us? Nope. Okay, have a cup of tea and good night.